Hello, church history friends. My name is Peter Smith, and tonight I have the joy of welcoming you to our fifth evening lecture in the Community of Christ Historic Sites Foundation's Summer Lecture Series. We greatly appreciate you joining us this evening to listen to a community of speakers share the history behind our reunion tradition and the unique story behind three campgrounds. Barb Walden will be our first speaker this evening, and she will share a brief history behind the reunion tradition. Her lecture will include clips from a film located in the church archives that features visits to four reunion grounds filmed during the summer of 1946. Following Barb's presentation, I'll introduce Kim Naten, who will share the story behind the Samish Island campgrounds located in Washington State. I'll then introduce Robert Cook, our third speaker, who will share with us the story behind the Onset community campgrounds located in eastern Massachusetts. Our last speaker this evening is Valeria Bryant, sharing the story behind the Bluff Springs campground located just north of Pensacola, Florida, close to the Alabama state line. Unfortunately, Valeria is not able to join us this evening in person. So Barbara Walden will read Valeria's research on her behalf. Now, before we begin tonight's lecture, I want to introduce you to my co-host, Megan Reed. Megan is working on her master's degree at Louisville Presbyterian Theological Seminary. This summer, she is serving as a student intern for the Kirtland Temple and will be assisting behind the scenes throughout the lecture series. In fact, Megan is here tonight thanks to your generous donations given to the Community of Christ Historic Sites Foundation in support of the Alma Blair Internship Program. Thank you for your generosity. Although the historic sites are temporarily closed for public safety due to COVID-19, the stories from church history and the preservation and maintenance of the historic sites continue on even in the midst of the pandemic. Donations from tonight's lecture help support the Community of Christ's historic sites. Thank you for your generous support in helping preserve our shared church heritage. Megan has dropped an online donations link in the chat box, along with an address for those who wish to donate by mail. Thank you, Megan. Now for our evening program. Let me introduce you to our first speaker this evening. Barbara Walden is the Executive Director of the Community of Christ Historic Sites Foundation, a position she has held for nearly 10 years. She is the former Site Director of the Kirtland Temple and past President of the John Whitmer Historical Association. Welcome, Barb, and thank you for joining us this evening. I'll turn the microphone over to you as we are all ready to hear the origin story behind our beloved tradition, the annual reunion.
Thank you, Peter. Much appreciated. And it's exciting to see how many of you are taking advantage of the chat feature and saying which of the many campgrounds is your favorite. We have a diverse group who've gone to campgrounds all over the country, all over the world. And so it's exciting to see that. Thank you all for participating in that feature of this webinar. As Peter mentioned, I'm going to talk about the history of the annual tradition, reunion. I can't talk about this reunion tradition without giving credit to a number of great historians who have researched this topic over the years. Church historian Dick Howard included a bit of reunion history in his second volume of church history. In addition, Mark Shear included a lot of information about the first reunion in his second volume of church history. And Morris Draper, who some of you may have known, he wrote an excellent article that was featured in Restoration Studies Volume 2 about our history at campgrounds and reunions, and even includes a little bit about youth camps. So I know we're beginning this lecture tonight, and I've already given you some homework assignments, but if you find yourself very interested in learning more about our history of reunions, those three resources are great resources. All the information I learned over the years comes from those sources, along with a treasure chest of materials found in the Community of Christ archives. In fact, the many historic photos I'll share with you tonight come from and are courtesy of the church archives. So let's dive into this reunion history. I'm going to share my screen and open up a PowerPoint where you can see some of these images. I hope you're all able to see the screen. And this wonderful image of a Maysville, Missouri reunion in 1899. So since the fall of 1883, Community of Christ members have gathered annually to attend reunions or family camps. The reunion tradition started in response to financial concerns taking place in the RLDS, or now Community of Christ Church, in the 1880s. Our faith community met for general conferences, or what we would call world conferences, twice a year. They would meet in the spring around our April 6th anniversary, and then again in the fall around September or October of every year. The cost of gathering to these conferences created hardship on the church, and especially the individual church members who traveled twice a year together. The location of the conferences would alternate between the eastern states of the church, like Ohio and Illinois, and the western states, like Iowa and Missouri. So there was quite a bit of traveling involved to attend these conferences. At the spring and fall conferences in 1882, it was proposed that the church meet only once a year for these general conferences, rather than twice, because it was too expensive and they thought it was unnecessary to meet more than once. But just like today, early church members loved to get together at the conferences because it was a time of fellowship, direction, a time of spiritual nourishment. Often church members would leave the conferences feeling inspired, refreshed, and energized for the journey ahead. So the thought of losing the fall conferences from the schedule meant a great loss for members who grew accustomed to these gatherings. As Mark Shear said, the greatest concern was not that not meeting in the fall, but the concern was that there would be a loss of spiritual strength that they enjoyed when the leadership and membership assembled together in their area. The next general conference in the spring of 1883 was held in the Kirtland Temple. It was a pretty big deal for a few reasons. Historically, this conference was the first time church members gathered in the Kirtland Temple for a church conference since the 1830s. It was a church-wide extravaganza as church members traveled near and far to attend. Reporters interviewed church leaders during the conference, and the image that you see here appeared in the Harper's Weekly, a national publication. Reporters attended and published their observations. Joseph Smith III preached on temperance and was interviewed a number of times. Well, the topic of canceling the fall meeting came up again at this conference. However, two guys, Charles Derry and John Pierce Hawley, who you see here, co-sponsored a proposal that said that instead of canceling a fall conference, the church should host regional, what they called annual reunion meetings. Derry and Hawley's proposal was a win-win in many ways. It gave people the opportunity for fellowship with church members from outside of their town. Reunions would include worship that would continue to energize and inspire those in attendance. Interaction would happen between church leaders and membership, just like at the annual conferences. Even better, unlike the general conference, the reunion was not to conduct church business. So no need to sit through those boring business meetings at a reunion. Soon a committee was formed to explore these regional reunion meetings. Of course, a committee was formed. That's what we do in Community of Christ. The organizing committee and representatives from the Western districts gathered in the upper room of Calvin Beebe's store in Council Bluffs that summer. They selected Benjamin Leland's farm as the location for the first reunion. His farm was located about 35 miles from Council Bluffs. The farm included a grove of trees that would offer shade and a creek that would act as a source of water for reunion guests and their horses. The dates were set for September 15th through the 23rd, 1883. Word went out through the Herald and included the warning that there would be, quote, no saloons, shows, swings, or any other profane amusements allowed on the grounds, end quote. Church leaders worked with the railroad for special rates for church members. They also built a temporary train platform on both sides of the tracks so members could hop off the train safely. The platform was located closer to the reunion spot, but attendees still had to walk about a quarter of a mile to get to Leland's Grove or Leland's farm. The first reunion was held for 8 days, and it rained for 4 of those days. It was a pretty soggy time. Families slept in tents and cooked for themselves. Firewood was provided along with hay for horses. Like our reunions today, they held preaching services, prayer and testimony meetings, and baptisms, and the schedule stretched from 9 a.m. in the morning to 9 p.m. each day. But despite the dreadfully wet weather, the first reunion was considered a grand success. The attendance was much higher than they expected, and the benefits enjoyed at General Conference were experienced at the regional gatherings. They found spiritual renewal, contact with church leaders, unity among church members, fellowship, and contact with a larger church community for those saints who often felt isolated. The momentum started in Western Iowa spread to reunions, soon taking place in other regions. By the 1890s, the church began purchasing land to use as reunion campgrounds in Iowa, Maine, and California. This excitement was also not limited to the United States alone, as soon church members outside of the United States were also experiencing the benefits of reunions. Church members as far away as Great Britain, Tahiti, and Australia. Thanks to Peter Judd, I learned this week that reunions began in Great Britain as early as the 1890s. That's pretty soon after the first reunion in Western Iowa. We also weren't alone in this tradition, as the United States was seeing a surge of camp meetings during the 19th century. As David Howlett, one of the church historians, once noted, our history of the annual reunion parallels the evolution of the camp meeting among American evangelical Protestants happening around the same time. Although there may be a shared history there, Community of Christ campgrounds and reunions in many ways have forged their own unique identities as we attempt to create Zionic communities each summer. The Community of Christ Museum collection includes a wonderful collection of historic images from reunions all over the world and a few documents and artifacts as well. Here's a flyer announcing the reunion at Clitheroe, Minnesota. What people used to furnish their tents is always fascinating. Milk crates were common for tent tables, and canvas tents were very popular for that home away from home experience. Here you see the old army tents decorating the Kirtland Temple grounds where reunions took place from as early as 1911 through 1959. Those army tents were stored in the basement of the temple for years. Reunions were also held for a long time at the historic sites in Nauvoo. They had campfires near the river, tented all over Emma and Joseph's lawns. Meals were served at the Nauvoo House, and youth campers bathed in the Mississippi River. But by far, my favorite reunion artifact dates back to 1894 and was owned by an early church member in Holden, Missouri. Initially, I thought it was a wooden side table. I mean, it looks like a wooden side table, a prized possession for any reunion tent. As I went to lift it up, though, I found that the top wood piece was connected to that lower wooden piece by a hinge. You could literally open up the table. And when one lifts up that wooden lid, this is what you discover. Can anyone guess what that is? Yes, it was used at a time when the outhouse was another gathering place at the annual reunions. This is more for those not interested in the hike to the outhouse. I struggled to find stories from women at reunions. I know they were there, but they don't appear to record their stories or experiences. And as I skimmed through old heralds and other church publications, I think I can understand why women were not recording their histories. They were consumed with responsibilities. They were the cooks who made the meals and performed a KP. They led nearly all of the classes, youth age through adults. At reunion, except for the adult male priesthood classes, of course, they wrote, directed, and choreographed evening plays. They shared testimonies in worship. They offered ministry of music. They served as nurses throughout the week. All of this in addition to managing their tent or cabin and keeping a watchful eye on their families. I can only conclude that women were superheroes during some of these historic reunions. I should note, it looks like there's a group of suffragettes that appear there in the upper, my upper left-hand corner. That's a group of women at the Onset reunion grounds, and I would love to hear the story behind this photograph. It's certainly one of my favorite photographs from the church archives. The big tent was a staple feature at many of our historic reunions. It was used for large worship services and classes. Although it was one large open arena, it was often divided up for multiple activities to take place simultaneously. One missionary describes the big tent experience at the Lamoni reunion, a reunion that took place not too far from the Graceland campus before the Guthrie campgrounds were purchased and the reunion was moved up to Central Iowa. Here's how the big tent activity was described at that Lamoni reunion. Quote, "It was my privilege and pleasure to teach two classes daily for 5 days on the theme Religion in the Home. In another part of the big tent, Professor Jerry Runkle of Graceland was teaching classes in Economics in the Home. As the classes alternated, persons interested in the twin problems involved in marriage and home building, that is spiritual and economic problems, could attend both classes. In another part of the big tent, Floyd McDowell was teaching a class in leadership, and elsewhere farmers were studying their problems of soil and farm management. In fact, from the little ones of kindergarten age on up, everyone in some way was thinking about the same thing every day," end quote. Another theme that appears in our reunion history is recreational activity, especially baseball. It was an afternoon staple at reunions across the country. I remember afternoon games at Buckhorn Reunion Grounds growing up. At the Erie Beach reunion in Canada, even the guest minister had baseball included in their reunion assignment. Jim Poirier said that at the Erie Beach reunion, located in Ontario, Canada, the grounds are within the city limits and it has the only baseball field in town. On the Wednesday evening of reunion, going back as far as they can remember, the entire community is invited to the grounds for a barbecue, funded by the reunion, and a ball game between the town and the reunion participants would take place. So in actuality, the reunion team is the visiting team. Jim said, "When I was given a reunion assignment one year, the director printed out the following, quote, preach Sunday and Thursday, teach the adult class, and right field Wednesday night," end quote. Music is another feature appearing at reunions over time. There are at least two hymns included in our hymnal that were written at reunions. Dick and Barbara Howard's Now in This Moment was written in 1978 during a reunion for appointees and their families at Graceland. In addition, Dennis Aldridge's hymn, Lord, Thou Hast Brought Us to This Place, or Lord, You Have Brought Us to This Place, was written for the Dunfield House where the British Isles reunion takes place every year. In fact, I hear it's not an official reunion at Dunfield until they sing Dennis's hymn. I have to thank Dick Clothier for providing the information about hymns written during reunion. He is the master of church history when it comes to our historic hymnody. Well, a few years ago, a Community of Christ Church member donated a copy of her family's video that featured a reunion road trip taken during the summer of 1946. The family's adventure included visits to four different reunions located in Michigan, Canada, and Alabama. Tonight, I'd like to share an edited version of that family video. It's an opportunity to step back in time to see what reunions would have looked like nearly 75 years ago. Thank you. Share my screen again as we wrap up this talk. I'd like to end with a story from Joseph Smith III's memoirs. It's a story that he shares about an experience he had at the 1884 reunion. So this is 1 year after the first reunion held in Leland's Grove. He said that he was walking around the reunion and he came across two men who had asked him where the strangers are supposed to go at reunion. And he was puzzled by their question, thinking that they were looking for a place to put up their tent. So he said that he would conduct them over to the captain of the ground police, who would locate a place for them to put up their tent. And these two men said, no, no, that's not what we're asking. We have already found a place to put up our tent. We're strangers here, and we have received so many invitations to breakfast. We are wondering if you folks ever had any strangers with you before. Well, Joseph III was a little embarrassed that he misunderstood their question, and he says, pardon me. He says, there are no strangers here. We are all members of one large family, made so by the gospel bonds of Christ. When others come among us, we feel they too are our friends, and we make them welcome. You walked with them a little while longer and introduced them to some of the people there at the reunion. And at parting, he said to him, just continue your journey around the camp and be assured that while you stay, you will be welcome to sit down with any of these people at meals and partake of their hospitality. They will ask you no questions, but will gladly see that you are well cared for. I feel like this story really captures our quest to gather to Zion, where there are no strangers among us, as Joseph Smith III shared, and it continues to be experienced at our annual gatherings as church members reconnect with our historic communitarian roots in shared meals, housing, and labor at reunion. It's no wonder that a number of our reunion grounds include Zion in their names. Tiona Park in Australia, Tiona being Tahitian for Zion, Sionita in Texas, and Ziontario in Ontario, Canada. Today, the World Church website shows campgrounds located in 9 countries and at least 26 states. The last I heard, our faith community hosts at least 86 reunions each year and around the globe. It's that one time when we recreate our communitarian experience of living all things in common, similar to the early Christians in the book of Acts. I think Dick Howard describes our reunion tradition the best when he said, the story of reunions in the church is that of open-minded seeking in the midst of a body of open-hearted sharers. Do you remember when that story became your own? In that electrifying moment under God's open skies as you saw it and as someone else cared about your seeking? End quote. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Barb, for sharing about the origins of reunions. And thanks especially for sharing those photos, the quotes, and especially the video tonight. That was fascinating to see what reunion was like so many years ago. Our second speaker this evening is Kim Naten. Kim serves as Mission Center President for the Greater Pacific Northwest USA Mission Center, which includes Alaska, Western and Central Oregon, and Western and Central Washington. She grew up in the greater Seattle area, has been a lifelong member of Community of Christ, and has worked for the Mission Center since 2009, the last 3.5 years as Mission Center President. She and her husband, Rick, live in rural Southwest Washington, about halfway between Seattle and Portland, and have 2 adult children, both married, and a 3-year-old grandson who keeps them laughing and smiling daily. Kim's presentation this evening begins with a video she contributed to the We Are Storytellers project. This project features over 40 gifted storytellers in Community of Christ sharing some of their favorite stories from church history during the time of COVID-19. Megan has dropped a link to the Storytellers project in the chat box if anyone wants to check out these talented storytellers after tonight's lecture. Kim is one of those gifted storytellers, and she opted to share the story behind her campground. I hope her video inspires you to share the story of your campground with the We Are Storytellers project as well. So let's watch the video.
Hi there. My name is Kim Naten, and I serve as Mission Center President for the Greater Pacific Northwest USA Mission Center. Many of you may have visited Samish Island Campground or have heard of its beauty. Samish Island is located about an hour south of the U.S.-Canadian border in Washington State. I'm fortunate to have practically grown up on these grounds, having attended camps and reunions there since my early childhood. I was even married there. I call Samish Island my spiritual home, and each time I pull into the driveway onto the grounds, I am filled with a sense of peace and a sense of coming home. The story of how Community of Christ acquired these grounds is a story of immense generosity and humility, and I'd love to share it with you. Back in the late 1920s, a young Norwegian couple by the names of Sig and Tora Fristad purchased a large parcel of property on Samish Island in Skagit County, Washington, which is about an hour or so north of Seattle. They started out raising cattle there and eventually turned to raising turkeys. Sig happened to work with a minister from a church very few in the area had really ever heard of, the Reorganized Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Over time, the two men became friends, and through that friendship, Sig and Tora eventually made the decision to join this little church. The Freestads, who later moved away from Samish Island but still owned the property, developed a deep appreciation for the camping programs that the church offered its youth. At this time, the church camps in that area took place at Silver Lake, just around Everett, Washington. Sig and Tora came to feel so strongly about the need for a dedicated site for church youth camps that they ultimately felt led by the Holy Spirit to gift their farmland, over 80 acres, to the church for this purpose. The Freestads presented their proposal to both the British Columbia, Canada district as well as the Seattle district in 1957. While the BC district gladly accepted this generous gift, surprisingly, many folks in the Seattle area did not want to accept this and wanted camps to remain at Silver Lake. It took some time, along with a visit from one of our apostles, but the gift was finally accepted by a fairly close vote at the district conference in 1958, and by summer of 1959, the first reunion was held there. Between 1959 and the early 1960s, a dining hall and restroom facility were built, along with wooden tent platforms. I remember staying in one of those old canvas tents. Sig and Tora purchased a home across the street from the property and served as the campground's first caretakers. Even as the campground developed, with cabins and classroom buildings being added, Sig and Tora remained deeply involved in the operations and events of the campground. Anyone in my age bracket who spent time at Samish as a child will remember Sig's patience and understanding on the dish line, teaching us how to operate the commercial dishwasher, even himself doing the lion's share of the work during our camps and reunions. We will also recall the beautiful floral arrangements that Tora created from her own garden, including the beautiful hanging flower baskets that decorated our dairy barn turned chapel, where we held church services, talent shows, and sing-alongs. In the early 1970s, a man-made saltwater lake was dug out near the bay so that campers would have a safer and warmer place to swim, canoe, and play. That lake was named Freestad Lake, and while I'm sure they felt honored, I also recall that Sig and Tora were somewhat uncomfortable with the attention that it brought them. The Freestads were humble, generous saints who responded to what they understood as the urging of the Holy Spirit to provide a place for youth and families to gather together in fellowship and community. Samish Island Campground and Retreat Center has become a home to a wide variety of user groups, from Zen Buddhists to artists to recovery groups. Even the Samish Nation, the descendants of the original inhabitants of the island, have reconnected with this land and are participating in the continued development and care of their native grounds. Many generations of people from around the Pacific Northwest and well beyond have come to love Samish Island as a sanctuary of peace, a gathering place where hearts and spirits are filled and all are welcome. I think Sig and Tora would be amazed and proud of how their generous gift to the church has continued to touch and change lives far beyond their original vision. They're our heroes, models of grace and generosity, two humble and faithful servants who sacrificed a great deal so that others could experience the blessings of community and God's sacred creation in this little corner of the world.
Welcome, Kim, and thank you for sharing your video, and thank you for joining us here live this evening to share the story behind Samish Island.
Thanks for having me. It's been a pleasure, and it was a lot of fun to record that video. It brought back so many memories of having grown up there at Samish, and brought to mind some of the unique features about Samish Island Campground, one of which is that we actually share the campground with the Canada West Mission Center, as well as Inland West Mission Center. And so we have a broad community that calls Samish Island home. As I mentioned in the video, there are a number of non-Community of Christ groups that also have come to love Samish Island. And it's really true that they don't just rent the campground from us for their camp. They are invested and love Samish as much as those of us who grew up there. And we often see at our work weeks Several people, a number of people will come from the non-community of Christ user groups to come. They donate financially and help support Samish in so many ways. The thing that is the most special, I think, about Samish, and I know many of you will agree, is the sense of community that is built around a campground. And that community is built with all the folks that use the campground, but even within those camps and reunions. You know, I grew up going to reunion there, and when I went to reunion, I knew that I would arrive and have about 200 more parents watching after me and correcting me and disciplining me if necessary. As I started going as a young parent, I also knew that my children would have a lot of extra parents there watching them as well. And it has just always meant so much to me and to so many others that our campgrounds provide that space of extended family. We're more than campers coming with a shared desire to be at camp. We really become family in those weeks, and Samish Island has provided that for so many people, far beyond the initial, you know, Seattle stake and BC district. And it's really become a spiritual home to people all over the world, in fact. And so this last little video is just kind of a panorama that shows you Samish today, some of the newer buildings that have been built. And it was created for a special reunion week that we held week before last, featuring all three of the campgrounds in our mission center. But hope you enjoy this last little vision of Samish Island. Thanks.
Thank you, Kim. The story of Samish Island was fascinating, and the grounds are breathtaking. Our next speaker this evening is Robert Cook. Robert Cook was born in Providence, Rhode Island, the offspring of the marriage of a fifth generation Southwestern Iowa descendant of the original church to a Cape Cod fishing and cranberry growing family. He is retired from a career working and teaching in computer science disciplines, as well as patent law. His interest in church and family history took him to Nauvoo, where he is the Mission Center President of the Community of Christ Cedar Valley Nauvoo Mission Center. He spent all of his summers as a child and teen at the Onset Reunion Grounds, where he developed a lifelong interest in intentional communities and our gathering places. Welcome, Robert, and thank you for joining us this evening. I'll turn the microphone over to you as we look forward to hearing the story behind the unique campground located at Onset, Massachusetts.
So can you hear me okay, Peter?
Yes, I can.
All right. It's my privilege to be here and to tell you a little bit about Onset. A lot of people get tired of me talking about Onset, and so I don't often bring it up because I could just talk all the time. First of all, the only thing I can tell you about really is my experience and my understanding of my experience. I apologize to all of those who remember details and dates better than I do, and also apologize to the World Church staff who never really could make sense out of what the Onset Reunion Grounds turned into. It was so different from what they were used to dealing with in reunion grounds. I can assure you that for those of us who grew up there, it made perfect sense, and it still makes perfect sense for us. I contend that the Onset Reunion Grounds is a Community of Christ intentional community, which is not a term we often use. Wikipedia defines an intentional community as a planned residential community designed from the start to have a high degree of social cohesion and teamwork. The members of an intentional community typically hold a common social, political, religious, or spiritual vision. And the thing that really sets the Onset Reunion Grounds apart from, I believe, all or almost all of our other reunion grounds is the fact that there is a year-round community of Christ people who live on the grounds. The people of Southern New England who belonged to the RLDS Church in 1889 joined with the saints in Maine to hold a reunion at a rented campground. Soon two reunions were being held, one in Maine and one in Southern New England. I might mention that throughout almost all of my life, Southern New England was a separate district from Maine. We knew they were there. Some of our people went there. I never went to the campground in Maine until I was an adult, and then just for a short visit. But now we are one again as the New England Mission Center. The desire to have a permanent campground for reunions in Southern New England grew, and in 1910, after 14 years of searching, a property was purchased at Onset, Massachusetts, a quaint Victorian village on Cape Cod. Onset was also known as a spiritualist community, and one group of spiritualists still exists on that campground. Now I'm gonna see if I can screen share. Okay, so there we go. This is a view similar to what you already saw in one of Barb's pictures, and I'm calling this We Have Our Own Campground. It's a view that most of us who have been there are familiar with, looking over Muddy Cove to part of the campground where there were tents at that time. In 1911, the first two-week reunion was held at Onset in tents. The minutes of the reunion reflect the high degree of communal organization that existed from the start, with various community officers and laying out lots for family tents. The minutes carefully record each meeting, including the number of testimonies, prophecies, tongues, and interpretation of tongues. The next year, in 1912, the bishop told the people that he had arrived at a conclusion regarding the redemption of the grounds, and that he had something to offer the saints which ought to thrill them and meet with a ready response from all. He asked for a consecration from all that the debt might be raised and everyone be eligible to secure a lot on which to build themselves a little home. That it would be in a sense of an inheritance where all could come freely and dwell in peace. I was very interested to find this particular quote, which rings true over 110 or 15 years. By 1913, 1 year later, the summer cottages were already being constructed. So let me move along. Let's see, this is the 1911 reunion where tents are being used, and they were laid out in a very orderly fashion with a street down the middle. This is similar to the other scenes you've seen of a meeting tent. And here we go in 1913, 1 year after the bishop said that people might be able to build themselves a little home, little homes called cottages. And by the way, I've been sort of Midwesternized where I'm inclined to call these cabins, but the people at Onset in their English tradition call them cottages. So 1913 cottages were already being constructed. My grandparents built a two-story cottage for themselves and their six-year-old son, who was my father. Streets were laid out and named with familiar names: Zarahemla, Nephi. And I might mention that my first girlfriend's father's first name was Moroni. He wasn't an angel, but he was indeed named after the angel Moroni. In 1925, a tabernacle was built. This tabernacle still stands today with very little modification from the original structure. The sea air breezes still provide Mother Nature's air conditioning. Some of my most vivid memories are of sitting in the tabernacle in the summer evening prayer and testimony service. During the Great Depression of 1929, many church families were destitute, and some of them who had summer cottages moved and lived year-round in them. I don't know if this was when people first started living year-round, but I have heard this said, and I haven't been able to track down specific information about earlier people. The other significant event was that many families came to stay all summer in their little cottages. The fathers would go back to their jobs in the city during the week and leave their family in the safe and comfortable Onset campground community. My father spent all of his summers at Onset. Then he went to Graceland for a year and came home with my mother, who had grown up in southwestern Iowa and was at Graceland with him. About 1935, my parents bought a little cottage across from my grandparents' house. And in the upper left corner, you will see what it looked like when they first bought it. In 1942, they had their first child, and over the next few years, three more children arrived, and the cottage was added on to. You can see in the lower left corner, being added on to, and in the lower right, you can see the novel addition of indoor plumbing. Up till that time, indoor plumbing was not allowed. All of my siblings and I spent all of our summers, as well as weekends in the fall and spring, at Onset. Since then, as you can see, my parents developed a cottage that suited them over the years. And on the campgrounds, you will find cottages anywhere from a few who I would call antique cottages, who are similar to the picture a couple of times ago. And people still use them and stay the summers in them. Then there are, at the other end of the spectrum, there are people who have built full-scale suburban type homes on their lots on the campgrounds in order to retire in them. When my parents retired, they moved to their little cottage on the campground, where they spend many pleasant and peaceful years with friends and family. When my father and mother passed away, I was the one interested in maintaining the family cottage, and my wife and I still spend unfortunately, few delightful weeks there during the summer at Onset. My story is not unique, but is shared by my father's childhood friends and their descendants, many of whom, those descendants of my father's friends, are also lifelong friends of mine. Onset became quite a tight community, and I'm still related to a large portion of the residents. The community, interestingly, has never had a single charismatic leader, which is fairly common for intentional communities, but rather has been governed by a board of trustees. There have been leaders, both spiritual and temporal, but New England Yankees are not much inclined to give up total control to anyone. There have been shifts over the years in the makeup of the community and the way the community operates and manages the common property. And you will see here some Air Force or Army barracks that were brought in at one point and called hutments. And they've been used and maintained over many years. This is a much more modern facility, which has several apartments as well as a number of motel-style sleeping rooms. There have also been other community buildings that have been built, a big commissary and dining hall, gathering hall, and a respectably sized chapel attached to it. One unique feature of the community that has provided longevity and cohesion, but also provides a certain edge of insecurity, is the fact that the entire campground land remains the property of the church. Church membership is required to have a lot lease. Cottage owners receive the use of their lot under a lifetime lease and then build their own cottage. When I was a young boy, my mother would feed us all breakfast, and then as we went off to play, would always remind us, "Don't leave the grounds." She knew that other mothers would watch us wherever we went. That phrase has remained with me and has taken on broader meaning over the years. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Robert. Our final speaker tonight is going to be with us through her research only this evening, and her name is Valeria Bryant. Before we go there, I just want to remind people, we promised you an hour tonight. It is, that hour has come and gone. And so for those of you who may need to leave, just know that you're welcome to leave if you need to, but we will continue on until the end, including an opportunity for questions and answers. Our panelists have agreed to stay on with us for a while afterwards to answer any questions you have. So you're free to continue to enjoy tonight's event, but if you do need to leave, just know that we understand completely. So our final speaker will be with us through her research only this evening, and her name is Valeria Bryant. She's a graduate student at the University of West Florida. The history shared this evening comes from Valeria's ongoing research for her master's thesis, a study that focuses on the history of Bluff Springs Campground. Barb Walden will share her Valeria's written work while we enjoy a variety of contemporary images featuring Bluff Springs Campground.
Well, thank you, Peter, and hello again, everyone. I'm going to share my screen to show you some photographs of the campgrounds. The first image you see is not the campgrounds, but rather the Valeria Bryant, who is sharing the history of Bluff Springs Campgrounds with us tonight. Valeria writes, "Ordinary people can come together to achieve the extraordinary. This has become quite the normal for Community of Christ and Bluff Springs Campgrounds. Good evening, I'm Valeria Bryant, and I would like to share a little bit about my favorite place on earth, Bluff Springs Campgrounds. Bluff Springs is located approximately 30 miles north of Pensacola in McDavid, Florida. According to an account written by Edith Odom of McKenzie, Alabama, early in 1960, it became evident the Bruton Reunion Grounds would not accommodate the growing needs of our youth or meet the educational needs of our priesthood and women's department. Under the advisement and in collaboration with World Church leaders, a search committee was formed to locate a new home for our reunions. Soon a property which offered great promise was located. While the purchase of the new property was underway, another piece of property was suggested to the search committee by Brother Dan McCurdy. The alternative property, approximately 530 acres, presented by Dan McCurdy, seemed to have the greatest appeal. Those of what is now the Gulf and Alabama Northwest Florida Mission Centers have grown to know it well as Bluff Springs Campground. In the middle of April 1962, a loan was secured from the World Church, and the closing was set to take place. In July of 1966, Tommy Tolbert, treasurer, gave the following report, quote, payment of $12,000 to the bishopric, loan outstanding of $15,848.38, 198 lots fully paid through the family lot program, 75 to 100 committed to pay by the end of the year, which would bring $5,000 more. End quote. The name of the search committee was officially changed to Bluff Springs Campground Committee. In September of 1969, changed from Gulf States Reunion Committee. The senior-most structure on the grounds, which was first constructed at the Bruton Reunion Grounds, is the Tabernacle, an open-air shelter with dirt floors. First constructed in 1943, it was dismantled and moved to Bluff Springs in 1972. It continues to serve us today. Many worship services, meetings, decisions, activities, fellowship, as well as fun and games have taken place under the rafters of the Tabernacle. If those rafters could talk, the tales would not be too tall, I assure you. Brother Dick Dewar was part of building the structure twice. Much of the labor and items we continue to use today were donated. Pines were planted by so many dedicated disciples. One person shared, quote, I don't remember the exact year. My first experience was going to help plant pine seedlings. My dad gave me his coat to wear. I know he was cold, but it was a sacrifice he made for me, end quote. From another, quote, I saw God's love for all people in a profound way, end quote. Justice Manning, who's with us tonight, shared an account of the first couple of years at Bluff Springs as church members worked to establish the new grounds. Justice says, quote, the mission for the summer was to dig ditches for the sewer lines and clear brush in the areas where construction was planned. I was responsible for surveying the sewer lines. Because of the difference in elevation of the land, the ditches, dug by machinery and hand shovels, were sometimes deeper than the tall men who were working. So at times, they were in a ditch with walls higher than their heads. People like Cal Carpenter and Gil Remington. Looking back over the effort, we know we were blessed. No cave-ins occurred, even with such depth, and no support structure for the walls. During that week, each party was responsible for their own food and preparation, but we shared meals with each other. Showers were improvised with a hose overhead, and all water was cold, which felt good in the July heat after a long day's work. That was really a work week, one of the many during the improvements of this beautiful natural sanctuary that God had provided, end quote. Much of the kitchen equipment in the dining hall was donated. James Kelly approached the plant manager of Monsanto, a business located in Pensacola, Florida, and inquired about the surplus equipment. It's my understanding the plant manager was quick to donate the equipment to the grounds. Justice recalled, quote, in July 1969, we held the first youth camp for the Alabama district on the grounds. By then, five of the cabins were built, not furnished, and the dining hall had been erected, but not finished. For example, the dining room floor had not been poured, still dirt, and all campers stayed in tents. Then on the evening of July 20, 1969, the campers and staff watched the moon landing sitting inside the unfinished dining hall. Even though the TV reception was grainy, quite a feeling of excitement rolled around the group, end quote. Ordinary people willing to work together to achieve the extraordinary has become the normal for Community of Christ, including Bluff Springs Campgrounds, which has remained so for more than 50 years.
Thank you so much, Barb. And thank you, Valeria, for your research and for sharing that with us tonight. Thank you, everyone, for all of our panelists for sharing your research with us tonight. Thank you, Barb, Kim, and Robert for sharing with us this evening. And also thank you to Megan for helping co-host tonight and for all of your behind-the-scenes magic. Lastly, we share our thanks to you, our friends, and the audience for sharing your time with us and for generously supporting the Community of Christ Historic Sites Foundation with your donations. We simply could not host educational programs like tonight's lecture without your generous support. Thank you for helping preserve and share church heritage. Now, speaking of the summer lecture series, we have some exciting news to share, to announce to you tonight. There is a bonus lecture added today to the summer lecture series. Our friend Andrew Bolton, you may remember from a few lectures ago, will return to present a lecture titled 75 Years Later, Ending War, Forging Peace, The Legacy of U.S. President Truman and the Peace Mission of Community of Christ. Andrew's lecture will take place on the historic anniversary of when President Truman signed the ratification of the UN Charter by the US, making the United States the first country in the world to do so. On that same historic day, the second atom bomb fell on Nagasaki, Japan, and ended World War II. For additional information about this bonus lecture with Andrew Bolton, and to register, follow the link that Megan has provided in the chat box. I also encourage you to tune in next week when on July 30th, we explore the history behind the Community of Christ in the Philippines. Dr. David Howlett will be our guest speaker that night as he shares much of his field research on the stories of the significant people, events, and historic places that make up our church history in the Philippines. It's an evening you don't want to miss. Until next time, take care. Keep reading your church history and have a blessed night, friends.